Good afternoon. So we will do some solid state physics part now, which actually is a continuation of what you have been seeing by the lectures of Professor Shiprasad regarding the crystal structure, various types of crystal structures, and also the structural determination using mostly XRD, the X-ray diffraction technique. So with this basic ideas, we are in a position to go and see something on solid state physics. Not only that, even for the topic that we are doing in magnetism, as I told you during those lectures, most of the time the materials which we want for applications are mostly solids, and we need to understand the physics behind that. But if you remember, when I did magnetism, I talked about initially I talked about atoms. Now the question is, what is the difference between the physics of atoms and physics of solids? As we have seen in the case of atoms, we have this discrete energy levels, right? We have seen these various energy levels, discrete energy levels, we will call it 1s, 2s, 2p and so on. They are all discrete energy levels. Of course, they have some kind of a fine structure, but they can still be treated as very discrete energy levels. However, when you go to a solid, when you go from an atom to a solid, that means you have put a large number of atoms, atoms of the order of Avogadro number, if we are putting, that becomes a solid. In that case, what is going to happen to these energy levels? These energy levels will not be as discrete as you are seeing now in the case of atoms. On the other hand, they will actually, if I assume that this is the distance of separation between the atoms, as this distance decreases, that is what is going to happen when you are making a solid out of atoms. These energy levels, slowly they broaden, and I am just showing one of them. So, they broaden, and as the distance of separation decreases, that means they become closer and closer, these energy levels which were there earlier for the atom, they actually become more and more wide, and this I can call it as the bandwidth. So, this is the band structure idea that you know in the case of solids, which is not there in the case of atoms. In the case of atoms, you have fine structure split energy levels, but still they are discrete. However, when you make a solid out of atoms, you have these kind of bands, and the band idea is coming only in the case of solids. Now, one more point is there in this case, again something related to what I was answering to a question yesterday. As far as these core electrons are concerned, even when it actually goes from an atomic state to a solid state, this kind of a broadening will be very, very small, or effectively will be very, very small. If you go to higher and higher energy levels of the atom, they are the ones which are actually going to get broadened, as in this case. So, the so called core energy levels, for example, 1s is a core level. That is essentially the atomic character will be retained even when it actually is in the solid. So, the broadening happens only for higher energy levels. This is what is actually going to determine magnetism in some sense, which we have been talking about yesterday. We will come back to that in the other lectures. So, that way this is important for the magnetism discussion also. So, the core electrons, core levels are more or less unaffected, whereas the higher energy levels actually get broadened because of the more and more interactions that these atoms are subjected to when you are having a solid constructed out of an atom. With this basic idea, so as I mentioned, when we have solids, broadly we can classify them to be of two kinds for this discussion. One is the solids which are actually non-metallic, and the other set is metallics. So, we have metallic solids and non-metallic solids. In the non-metallic category, I will include insulators, semiconductors, all these things. In the case of metals, we have good conductors where we have large number of free electrons and so on. In this discussion, we have only very limited time. So, I will only talk about the physics of metals, or only one part of solids we will be able to discuss in this lecture series. So, I will straight away start and show you some of the very important properties of metallic solids, not just solids in general, but metallic solids. So, that is why I have given the title as free electron theory and the band theory. We will start with the free electron theory, and then we go to the band theory, which I was just telling how the energy bands are happening when you have the solid of various atoms. Before we do that, So basically you are going to deal with a large number of electrons. So the question that is coming to our mind immediately is, how you have various energy levels and you have large number of electrons. How these electrons are arranged or distributed in the allowed energy levels? This is a very important point, because this is going to determine what kind of a physical property this metallic solid is going to show. So the electron distribution among the various energy levels is a very, very important thing to do before we really take up this matter. The other issue one has to keep in mind, which was already done, is, as I told you, when you are constructing a solid out of atoms, you see that the complexity is much more, because you are having single atom in the atomic physics. In the case of solid state, you have a very large number of atoms to deal with. So the problem should have been extremely, extremely difficult. It's almost impossible to solve, but for a particular issue. That was what was actually talked to you in the last two lectures of solid state physics, namely the crystal structure. What is the advantage you have in the case of solids over the atoms, which actually helps you or helps in minimizing the complexity that is expected when you have solids compared to atoms? The extra advantage that you have in the case of solids is nothing but the symmetry. So you have seen various crystal structures, various symmetries associated with that. This was done earlier. So why the crystal structure and the symmetries are very important, this is what is going to be seen as you go along in this lecture series. So that is why first we do the crystal symmetry, this crystal structure, then we will go to the actual theory behind the electronic properties and so on of, in fact, for other properties as well of the solids. So the symmetry of solids gives you a very important advantage as far as the theoretical understanding of various physical properties of solids are concerned. So two things. One is, we should have an idea about the symmetry of the solid, various crystal structures, their symmetries associated with various structures. That is number one, that is done. And the other thing is what I was talking about just now, the way in which different electrons are accommodated among the various energy levels consistent with the given solid. This is to be understood before we really try to attack the problem of energy bands or things of that kind. So first let us see, let us ask this question. So as I mentioned, you need to know what kind of a distribution that you have for these electrons. Of course, we will not worry about the other part, the electrons only we will worry about. I will tell you why we are neglecting the other contribution. Slowly those things will come into picture. I will come to the those details as we go along. So the question is, how do we fill particles in general? Before we really discuss what happens in the case of electrons, let us have a very preliminary idea, very qualitative, at least a qualitative idea regarding the distribution of particles in general among the allowed energy levels in a particular case. So as I have written, this kind of this distribution, the nature of distribution that is possible, is going to be determined by the nature of the particles, as I am going to show you. And in this case, you have two varieties. One is a so-called classical particles, with which we are all very familiar, and the quantum particles. So the distribution of classical particles and quantum particles, these distributions are quite different as you go from the classical nature to the quantum mechanical nature. In fact, in the quantum mechanical nature, there are two that I'll show you. So the branch of physics which actually deals with these things or gives an answer to these kind of distributions, in addition to many other things, is the statistical mechanics. So we need to get a very elementary idea of statistical mechanics if you want to understand the physics aspect of metals or solids in general. So the crystallography is one idea that is very important. The symmetry related information is very important. And then the ideas of statistical mechanics also important in understanding these properties. So since you have already seen the crystal structure related issues, I will only talk about some ideas about the statistical mechanics part. To give you an idea about this, first let us take a very simple picture of what is meant by, so to see the difference between the particles which are distinguishable and particles which are indistinguishable. The indistinguishable particles are also called identical particles. So electrons, for example, they are identical particles. You can't name electrons A, B, C. So they are identical particles. You can have indistinguishable, distinguishable particles, like what I have shown here in this figure. I am taking two red balls and one blue ball. R stands for red, B stands for blue. So the question is, and you are given three boxes. You have three balls, two of them are red. These two red balls are exactly identical. You cannot separate them out, and you have another blue ball. You are to arrange them in three fashions, three different distinguishable arrangements you have to make using these three boxes. As it is obvious, you have only three possibilities as shown here. You can have an RRB combination, RBR combination, BRR combination. Suppose these R and R, these two red identical balls were having some difference, you would have got many more such distributions or many more such possibilities. If all the three balls were of different color, then you have a large number of combinations possible, many kinds of possibilities would have been possible. On the other extreme, if all the three balls were, let us say, red in color, then you would have got only one arrangement. You cannot tell this is different from this, is different from this, this is not possible. So you have only one kind of an arrangement if you have only all the colors to be the same. So that means it is a very simple picture, but it gives you a very important information. What is that information? Depending on the nature of the particle, depending on whether the particles, assume that these balls are particles, if these particles are identical, and when they are not identical, the number of distributions that is possible for a given set of energy levels, here the boxes are essentially the energy levels, this number is going to be quite different. So this is what you are seeing from this picture. So the number of possible ways in which you can arrange particles among various energy states is critically determined by the nature of these particles. First of all, whether they are distinguishable or not. If they are distinguishable, you have many more possibilities. If they are identical, you have very, very small number of possibilities or distributions. This is a very simple idea, but it gives you the very important difference between indistinguishability versus distinguishability. And in quantum mechanics, quantum particles are identical, they are indistinguishable, and as we are going to see, we are going to deal with electrons, you are actually discussing the identical particles in a very big way. So that is why this difference becomes very important for us. So particles in general, particles available in nature in general can be classified as identical particles and distinguishable particles. Strictly speaking, you have only this kind particles which are identical. Under certain conditions, the so-called classical conditions, they behave as if they are indistinguishable. And when they are distinguishable, the usual classical particles, when you have a dilute gas, kinetic theory of gases, what we do, we use the distribution which all of you know is nothing but the Boltzmann distribution. So the distribution that one talks about when you are talking about atoms or particles which are distinguishable, the so-called classical particles, when you tell it is distinguishable, when you are telling it is distinguishable, you mean that you are in the classical regime. Then you use the Boltzmann distribution, which you have used in various forms. In fact, Maxwellian distribution of velocities finally gave you the equipartition theorem which you used in other course. Coming to the quantum particles, the so-called identical particles, there are two categories. One is the Bose particles or bosons, other thing is fermions or the Fermi particles. So electrons, as I am going to show you, belong to this category of fermions. And you have bosons, simplest example of course is photon, which actually is a boson. So quantum particles, you have two categories, one is bosons, one is fermions. So let us see further what is the difference. So in that sense, we can have three kinds of particles, actually only two, but if you bring in the classical also into picture, under certain conditions, these quantum particles behave as if they are classical particles. If you bring them, that means you are treating them as distinguishable particles. The main thing to worry about in this case is that in the case of classical particles, they do not obey the Pauli's exclusion principle. Pauli's exclusion principle need not be worried about in the case of distinguishable particles, classical particles. What are the example? Any gas that can be approximated to ideal gas conditions, where you assume that you can track the various particle atoms. So you call this atom A, this atom B, and so on. You can track the atom every time, especially when it is very dilute and the temperature is very high. this approximation is valid, you will really get into an ideal gas situation. There you are justified in calling it as a classical gas, and this Pauli's principle will not be coming into picture. You can use the Boltzmann statistic without much of a problem. What happens when you have other particles? So quantum particles type 1, as I mentioned, they are called bosons. They are indistinguishable, identical. They do not obey Pauli's principle. Examples are helium 2-4, this is an atom, and as I mentioned, the photon. So the characterizing thing here is that if you have the spin of the particle to be an integer including 0, then the particles are bosons. There is a very important theorem which is connecting the two, the spin and the nature of this particle. I will not go into those details, but whenever the spin of a particular particle is an integer, then it has to be a boson. And the other category is that if you have quantum system particles, the particles which are called fermions, they are again indistinguishable, they are identical, but they obey Pauli's principle. Pauli's exclusion principle has to be followed here. These particles are characterized by spin which are actually half integers. For example, half starting with, that is the smallest number possible, smallest half integer. Example, electron, proton, neutron, we talked about it earlier also. All of them have spin half. Helium 2-3, this is an isotope of helium which actually has s equal to half, because this 3 is coming here, so that its spin is half here. So this is also a fermion. So you have quantum particles, you have bosons and fermions. Bosons have integer spins, whereas fermions have half integer spins. So this is something which is very different between the two. And when the temperatures are very high, energies are very high, both these particles, both bosons and fermions, behave as if they are kind of classical, behave as if they are distinguishable, then you can approximate them to be following the classical distribution function, which is actually the Boltzmann distribution, which all of you have done in the kinetic theory of gases. But the kinetic theory of kind of a treatment, as you have seen in the modern physics lectures, will fail when you come down to low temperatures and things like that, because the quantum features, wherever the quantum features set in, the Maxwell Boltzmann kind of a description will fail. Now our thing is, we are more worried about fermions because we are trying to see what happens to the electrons in the case of solid or in the case of metals, and electrons being fermions as mentioned here, we will only worry about, of course this is also an interesting topic, bosons, we will not go into those details. We will right now worry only about the fermions, the physics of fermions, the distribution of fermions. For example, as I mentioned earlier, if you have set of energy levels, you are given some fermions, like for example electrons, how do they arrange themselves among the various energy levels? This is an important issue for us to understand the properties of solids. So we will only worry about fermions from now onwards. Fermions also, we will mainly worry about electrons. Just to give you an idea about this, what I have shown here is, you are given two fermions, let us take two electrons, and you are given three energy levels, and you are also given another constraint that the total energy of this arrangement, whatever you are going to choose, must be equal to 2 epsilon. So you are given three energy levels. The value of the first energy level is 0, the ground state. The second is epsilon, but remember, epsilon is given as a doubly degenerate level, as we talked about yesterday. So that is why the two lines are there, the double degeneracy is here, and then you have another level which is non-degenerate, that means the degeneracy is 1, which has got an energy of 2 epsilon. Now you are given 2 electrons and you have to make sure that the total energy is exactly 2 epsilon. So how do you do that? One possibility is this one, you put one electron here or one fermion here, let us worry about electrons here, this is one here. So this is a 0 energy level, so this will not contribute to anything to the energy, and the other one can be put in this one here, so that total energy is 2 epsilon, because this is 0 and this is 2 epsilon times 1 is 2 epsilon. The other possibility is, you can ignore the ground state, you can ignore this state also, you can take two of them and both of them and put here. And here there is no problem, the Pauli's principle is not violated, even though they are supposed to follow the Pauli's exclusion principle because this is a fermion. But it is not violated because there is a degeneracy of 2 here. So as long as the degeneracy is there, you do not have to worry about it. It is taking here, one is here, one is here. Here again you can see that one electron in energy epsilon, the other electron in energy epsilon, the total energy is 2 epsilon. So, our original constraint is satisfied. You do not have any other choice in this case if you do not change your total energy. So, once the total energy is fixed, total number is fixed and the total energy levels are fixed, the degeneracies are fixed, then there is no other possibility in this case. So, like suppose I have, if you see both these things are written as x, why x? Because they are identical, I am calling as fermions means they are identical, they must be, there should not be any symbol that distinguishes them, and hence if I tell one as x, the other thing must be x. If I call the first one as a, there is nothing like first and second, you have to call both of them a, both of them x, both of them y. On the other hand, if the same thing was done in a classical manner, it was treated, these things were treated as a classical particle, I should have been calling one as a, other thing as b, then as in the case of the ball example, you would have seen, you would have got many more possibilities. Similarly, if I did not have the Pauli's exclusion principle condition when it was a boson, then again the number will be different. I am not going to those pictures, but one can actually construct something like this. I will put some of these things in the lecture slides when I upload it. So, the point is, depending on the degeneracy, depending on the energy levels, depending on the total energy constraint, so total number of particles is a constraint here, total energy is a constraint here, degeneracies are fixed in the problem, energy levels are fixed in the problem, then so one can actually find out how various electrons can be distributed among various energy levels. The total number has to tally. So, this becomes an important issue as far as filling electrons in the various energy levels of a solid is concerned also. So, this idea how the electrons get distributed among various energy levels is actually determined or given by the ideas of statistical physics. So, what is a point? This is what I have been mentioning. You are given a fixed amount of energy, that is a constraint, number of particles is fixed, degeneracies are fixed, energy levels are fixed. Then what is the distribution corresponding to this very important, the equilibrium situation. That means the situation where the system is in equilibrium. We can have various possibilities, but we are looking at the equilibrium situation, distribution function corresponding to the equilibrium scenario. So, when the system is in equilibrium, what kind of distribution, how many electrons will be in the first level, how many will be in the second level, how many will be in the nth level. This information is very crucial, especially when it is regarding the equilibrium situation, because we all everything we are going to discuss for equilibrium situations. So, equilibrium distribution function is very important. So, what we are trying to look at is, we want to find out what kind of a distribution function I am going to get for fermions, in this case electrons, at a given temperature, when all the other things are fixed, like for example, your energy, total energy, energy level, degeneracy, all these things are fixed, what kind of a distribution function one can get, this is going to be very crucial in determining the physical properties. This is true for any property including the magnetic property that we have been talking about. So, this kind of a picture ultimately gives you this idea. What is this idea? This is given by this expression, I have cut short some of the things to save our time. So, Ni, that is a number of electrons that I am taking only electrons, number of electrons that is accommodated in an energy level ith energy level is related to Gi, that is Gi is the degeneracy of this particular level, e to the power of alpha, alpha is a constant, I will come to that very soon, e to the power Ei divided by kT plus 1. So, T is a temperature, K is a Boltzmann constant. Ei is the, or epsilon I is the energy level of that particular ith level. Using this, what is more often described is this Ni, the ratio of Ni divided by Gi, that means the number of particles in a particular energy level divided by that particular degeneracy of that level. So, that is called the distribution function. I have written as FD. FD stands for Fermi Dirac distribution function, which actually holds good for fermions, like electrons. As we are going to see, we are to worry about only electrons, electrons being fermions, the distribution function which is relevant for these fermions is nothing but a Fermi-Dirac distribution function, that is why this FD stands for Fermi-Dirac distribution function, which actually tells you at a given temperature, the equilibrium configuration corresponds to this particular function called the Fermi distribution function. It has got a particular nature, 1 by e to the power of alpha, e to the power of epsilon I divided by kBT, k or kB both represent the Boltzmann constant plus 1. Just to give you an idea about this, do not worry about this alpha. Alpha factor is essentially to take care that the total number is conserved. If you give me 1000 electrons, I should finally add up together and give you 1000. So, that is essentially played by this alpha quantity that we will see later. You can see a plus sign here. This is for the fermions. Just to show you one important difference, this is basically like a probability. I can think this as a probability distribution. Suppose I do the same thing for bosons. The main difference that is going to happen when I do the whole theory, I would have got a similar expression. The main difference would have been that I should have been getting a minus sign here. So, in the case of Fermi Dirac distribution function, it is a plus 1 here. In the Bose-Einstein distribution, which describe the Bose particles or the bosons, it will be minus 1 here. And why is it plus 1 here? Very simple argument is this one. You see what is the main difference between the two kinds of particles. Here the Pauli's principle must be valid. So, you can see because of this plus 1 here, this is always a positive quantity. This can never exceed 1. As I told you, this is essentially, you can treat it as a probability. This probability, if it goes to more than 1, that means you have 2, for example, if you are getting this to be 2, that essentially means that you have 2 particles surely there in a particular energy level. That means you are actually violating the Pauli's principle. So, that is avoided. Violating the Pauli's principle is completely avoided by this plus sign. This plus sign will always make sure that your denominator is more than 1, which means that this fraction will always be less than 1, at the most it will be 1, which actually tells you that the particle is actually there. So, this role of this plus sign here, this plus 1, is to basically make sure that the Pauli's principle is satisfied, it is not violated. In the case of bosons, as I have written down earlier, this condition is not there, the Pauli's principle condition is not there, and this minus sign is all right. In fact, you have many particles coming and occupying a particular energy level, very interesting physics there is possible in the case of bosons, but definitely not for electrons and fermions. So, this plus sign, the physical significance of plus sign in the context of Pauli's principle must be appreciated. So, this is the very important Fermi distribution function for determining how various electrons will get distributed among the electronic energy levels of a solid at a given temperature corresponding to the thermal equilibrium situation, because the properties that we are going to calculate will be all for equilibrium properties. So, this is the other requirement to study solids. So, first thing was the symmetry, second is this distribution function of solids, electrons in the case of solids. So, this gives you a very important clue to go ahead and see to do the problem of how electrons behave in the case of a solid, especially a metallic solid. Before we do that, still we have to do something more. So, as I mentioned, we will only worry about properties of metals, that means good conductors. So, as I mentioned, mostly we are dealing only with metals. Metals are very well known for various reasons. Many of the applications are dependent on metals, including magnetism in many applications, as I have shown you in the other lectures and whatever is remaining also. Many of these metallic materials are actually magnetic and they are very useful. Many of the permanent magnets, for example, which you are using, they are all metallic systems, may not be a single metal, but a metallic alloy where the theory can be essentially extended. So, metals are very important in that way. How do you characterize a metal? How do you tell that this is a metal and this is not an insulator? A metal is characterized by its positive temperature coefficient of resistance. What does it mean? That means if you increase the temperature, metals will definitely show an increase in the electrical resistance. This is a very important property of metals. So, the positive temperature coefficient of electrical resistance is a very important characteristic of a metal. They are also known to have very high electrical and thermal conductivities, because in general they have large number of free electrons. The free electrons are very large. Simple example is sodium, for example, as I have been talking earlier. Sodium is a metal because it has got very large number of free electron, free electron per atom. So this is a huge thing. When you have a solid, this contributes very much in the case of electrical conduction and thermal conduction. So metals are actually both good thermal conductors and electrical conductors. So if you look at historically how the things were developed, the first thing that was done was what is known as a free electron theory. Free electron theory in 1897 was the discovery of electron. So things started from there onwards. The first theory, which was called a free electron theory, came in 1900, and the theory was purely a classical theory, was given by Drude, and this is called the Drude model of metals, which actually is purely classical, no quantum mechanics. Of course, quantum mechanics was not there at that time. What was done there was, at that time, thermodynamics, classical statistical mechanics, these things were known, and the kinetic theory of gases, as I mentioned just now, was known. The theory of kinetic theory of gases was well known. So basically, Drude was trying to use the ideas of kinetic theory of gases to the solid. What is the connection? The connection is this. In the case of kinetic theory of gases, you have a dilute gas, we have atoms there moving around freely. In the case of metals, take a monovalent metal like sodium, every atom contributes one electron, monovalent means one electron is given. So basically what Drude assumed was, these electrons which are free, one electron from sodium, they essentially behave as if they are completely free. They will not be worried about the positive ions which are there. When you take one electron out of sodium, you are left with a sodium positive ion. You do not worry about it. So you only worry about these. If you are 100 atoms you are having, you have 100 electrons to be worried about, forget about all other things. Your container, you have to worry about, container is nothing but a crystal in this case, the crystal, sodium crystal, you have to worry about how these 100 electrons will behave, how they will distribute and things like that. So this is the analogy between the kinetic theory of gases, classical idea, and the Drude's classical idea of a metallic solid. Obviously, it will not be correct as you can see today, but you can see certain things were still explainable at that time even with this one. So what are the essential assumptions of Drude model? As I mentioned again, it is a classical model, it is a free electron model. There are two things. One is classical. Classical means there is no quantum ideas taken into account. Free electron means it will not worry about the positive ions which are left behind. The sodium ions are not at all treated in the problem. They are completely forgotten. So it is purely the free electrons which are taken into account, it is a free electron model. Classical and free electron model, that is what is the Drude model is. What are the assumptions that I already mentioned, but still it is listed here. Positive ions are assumed to be immobile, they are not contributing. The valence electrons, the last electron, the 11th electron gets completely detached and it wanders freely in the crystal. We do not, so the electrons are there. There can be an interaction between the electron and electron, one electron and another electron. This is also ignored. So you do not worry about electron-electron interaction. You do not worry about electron-core interaction. This is again an electrostatic interaction is possible there because you have a positive ion core and you have an electron, that is also ignored. Only way the electron, these electrons when they move, only way they see the core, the job of the core is basically to scatter these electrons. So it was assumed that its only role of these positive ions is to scatter these electrons as they move, otherwise they are completely free. So these are the assumptions of, these were not the correct things, they were the assumptions of under the Drude model, and when he worked out, these assumptions were used to derive something, that is what I am coming to. And typically if I try to work it out, typically the free electron density, number of electron per unit volume in a metal, if I take, it is something like 10 to the power of 22 cubic centimeter. It is a very large number compared to atomic physics, the number is very large. So you are basically dealing with a large number of electrons of the order of Avogadro number, as I mentioned, electrons put in a very small centimeter size crystals, metals. Then you have two, concepts which are very important. Again, these concepts were there again in the case of kinetic theory of gases. One is when these things move around, they get scattered by the positive ions. Though one can define what is known as a relaxation time, that means the time over which they are completely free from the scattering. When they move around, it is scattered by one positive ion. Then before it actually encounters another collision, another scattering, there is a time, lifetime over which it is free, that is called a relaxation time tau, this is tau. And if you can multiply this relaxation time with the meaningful velocity or the speed, you can actually define what is known as a mean free path, which again is defined in the case of kinetic theory of gases. Mean free path is the distance over which an atom can move before it encounters another collision. Something similar here, this is the distance over which this electron can move around so that it does not suffer a collision during that distance. Okay. So then what we are going to see is how you can actually talk about electrical conductivity, which is a very, very important, very basic property in this case of metals. So what you have is, you have an electron which is actually moving. When you do not have an electric field, you see that there is, at time t equal to 0, there is no electric field. So what happens is, these velocities with which they are moving, they will all be random, and this does not give rise to any current. As you all know, unless you apply an electric field with the help of a source of EMF, you do not establish a current even in the best conductor possible. So this is because there is a thermal velocity which actually is averaging to 0, which does not give rise to any particular directional flow of these charges, and hence you do not get a current. If you want to get current, what you have to do is, you have to apply an electric field. When you apply an electric field like this shown here, simple mechanical kind of things here. So when you apply an electric field, because of the negative charge, the electron moves in the opposite direction. So assume that this electric field has been applied just after the collision this electron has suffered. So assume that at that time its velocity was V naught. Now this actually is acted upon by a force E times C. The acceleration is divided by m, and over the next time period t, this is actually having a drift velocity. This is the drift velocity that it is going to happen, just because this applied electric field is directional and this is giving some particular direction for the charge flow to happen. Whereas this one will essentially average to 0 if you take over a finite time interval. This will not contribute because this is a thermal average velocity which will actually become 0, whereas the contribution that is coming from the applied electric field will survive, as we are going to see in the next one. So one can actually find out the average of velocity is the average of the first term and the average of the second term. So the average of the first term, as I mentioned, will go to 0 because of the random nature, whereas the second one can be written like this. These are all constants. Only thing that is coming is essentially the average of the time. What is the average time here? Average time over which this is able to survive the collisions. That is nothing but, by our definition, that is nothing but the relaxation time. So the average of time is nothing but the tau here. So this becomes minus EE tau divided by m. This is called the drift. This has dimensions of speed, as you know. This is called the drift velocity. So this drift velocity, which actually is non-zero, unlike the V naught, gives rise to the current, and that is why when you apply an electric field, connect a source of EMF to a piece of wire, metallic wire, you establish a current in that wire. And going further, if I have n number of electrons per unit volume, I can find out the charge density, the current density J actually is given by this expression. Some problem has happened, I will try to correct it when I do that. So this gives rise to n e square by m tau. This is actually what is not appearing here is tau. So this is n e square by m tau times E. This is the current density which actually is obtained by taking the number of charge carriers times the charge, that is E, multiplied by the speed will give you the current density, because charge when it is flowing gives rise to the current. So when I substitute this for Vd here, I get this expression. This is nothing but my Ohm's law. J equal to sigma E, the sigma is missing here. Sigma E is, J equal to sigma E is nothing but your Ohm's law, which actually can be shown that is exactly like V equal to I times R. So J can be converted as I divided by A. A is the area of cross section, and sigma is nothing but 1 over rho. Rho is electrical resistivity. And as you know, rho is related to the resistance, R is given by rho times L divided by A. So, one can rearrange this and you can show that this J equal to sigma E, where J is a current density, sigma is electrical conductivity, E is the applied electric field, can be written in terms of I and the applied voltage V, then you will get V equal to I times R, where R is electrical resistance, not a resistivity, that is nothing but the Ohm's law. So, J equal to sigma E is exactly same statement of Ohm's law, the way you write V equal to IR. So, this is the Ohm's law, which has found to be all right in many metals when it was initially tried for experimental confirmation. So, J equal to this, I will not worry about it, I already mentioned here. So, J equal to sigma E is a thing which is working, and to some extent this idea was possible to be explained with the help of this Drude picture. If you look at this, if you take the actual value, the experimental value of the resistivity of copper, this is something like 0.3 micro ohm centimeter, this is a unit of resistivity at 77 Kelvin. As I told you earlier, it will be more at the higher temperature, 273, that is the room temperature, it is around 1.56. So, this is the experimentally observed electrical resistivity. As I mentioned, I can define the mean free path. As I mentioned earlier, I know the relaxation time. So, if I am able to multiply this with a meaningful velocity, that is what I was using at that time. A meaningful velocity, I can actually get some characteristic length over which the scattering does not happen. What is that characteristic length? That is nothing but the mean free path. So, what is the velocity that I can use? The main thing I can use is the RMS velocity. RMS velocity, again, we know from the equipartition, from the kinetic theory of gases, we know what is RMS velocity. RMS velocity is obtained by equating the kinetic energy to the equipartition value. This is as shown here. This gives us the famous relation V RMS is given by square root of 3 kT by m, where k is a Boltzmann constant, m is the mass of the atom there, electron here. So, what Drude did was, he used exactly same idea here and try to see whether I can get V RMS using this at a given temperature and then try to see what happens. Typical value of this mean free path, relaxation time was 10 to the power of minus 14 second. That means when I apply, multiply with the RMS speed, we got RMS speed is something like this one. So, if I multiply the two, I get typically the mean free path to be 10 angstrom. 10 angstrom, you know how much is the distance in the case of a solid. Typically, the interatomic distance is 1 angstrom, 2 angstrom. So, it is able to have something like 10 angstrom, it is able to go without having any scattering, right. So, 10 angstrom separation, it is able to go without really, on the average, it is able to survive any collision. So, this is something which is, so if you have more and more mean free path value, that means it is a good, better and better conductor. So, this is something which is obtained purely classically, purely using the classical kinetic theory of gases, simply borrowing those ideas to the electron system. And in fact, some people are calling it as a classical free electron gas, FEG, free electron gas. So, because in analogy with the kinetic theory of gases, it was called free electron gas, still it is called free electron gas in some sense. So, this free electron, classical free electron gas was the idea used by Drude, and he got something like 10 angstrom as the upper limit of mean free path. How does the experimental value show? These are the problems to be worried about. So, Drude has got something, definitely something is there. The problems are like this. The conductivity is found to depend on temperature, whereas if you see, it is not really explained using this Drude picture. Much larger mean free path, more than 10 angstrom, were seen in many experiments. If you prepare the sample very carefully, carefully prepared samples, the mean free path, actual experimentally observed mean free paths were much larger than this 10 angstrom, which was predicted by the Drude's model. Other issue was associated with the Drude picture was this one, very important again. It was observed that the contribution to the electronic specific heat of some metals, it was much smaller than what was assumed for a free electron, classical free electron gas. I am going to the details of this. So, as far as specific heat of a solid is concerned, there was a problem. mean free path was concerned, there was a problem when we simply apply the classical rule picture. Obviously, that is expected because we know, today we know that we can appreciate these differences definitely must have existed. But now we are trying to see how these things were found out, how these discrepancies were solved one by one, so that today we have the correct theory which actually developed over a century. So what is the problem with the heat capacity or the specific heat? I use both in the same meaning. As was done earlier, you know equipartition theorem. When you have a solid, when you are giving heat, the heat can be absorbed by the positive ions. So here you cannot ignore the positive ions like the way Drude did. That's not possible. So these things can absorb energy, and you have the free electrons which can absorb the energy. So the heat capacity, when you talk about at a given temperature, and if you are using the classical kinetic theory kind of a model, you have to use the picture of these positive ions, which is a so-called lattice, which of course you know by this time, the lattice which will take some energy, so that the heat capacity contribution from the lattice is taken into account. Then there is a free electron contribution. There is a difference in the calculation between the two. So if you, these are all three-dimensional systems, as you know, when you take a molar substance, one mole of a substance, the total energy at a temperature T is given by, you have seen this, this is 3 times Na, that is the total number of degrees of freedom, and these atoms, these ions, the lattice actually vibrates. A vibrator has equipartition theorem gives you a half kbt for kinetic energy and half kbt for potential energy. So the total for each degree of freedom is kbt or kt, that is why this is multiplied with kt. So this gives you 3 RT, Na times kb is your universal gas constant as you know. So this gives you the ionic part or the lattice part, I will like to call it as a lattice part. For a solid, lattice makes more sense than the ionic term. So the lattice contribution is given by 3 RT. Now if the material, the solid was purely an insulator, this would have been the only term. But in our case it is a metal, it is a conductor. So you have the free electrons also coming into picture. They also are in a position to take the energy, but they are free. They are not like a vibrator, the lattice part. So they are free electrons. There is no anything that is free, there is no potential, there is no binding. So you have only kinetic energy contribution. Kinetic energy contribution from the equipartition theorem is only half kbt. So here again it is 3 Na, the number of degrees of freedom, because I am taking monovalent metal, 1 mole if I take, 1 mole of sodium for example, I have 3 times the Avogadro number, that is the total number of degrees of freedom where it can move. The velocities are in three dimensions, and then only kinetic energy contribution will be there, and hence I cannot multiply with kbt, but I have to multiply with half kbt. So I will get a 4 by, this is 3 and this is 3 by 2, sorry, this is 3 and this is 3 by 2, so it becomes 4.5. So and this Na times kb is R, so 4.5 is the heat capacity which is the derivative with respect to temperature. So heat capacity is independent of temperature, as this problem you would have seen earlier also, this is a problem of just when you have lattice part alone, this is a usual Debye picture. So where you have the, this result actually is the Dulong and Petit's behavior where it is constant at any temperature. Now what is extra is you are adding the electronic part also, but the idea is not changing. So you have a constant heat capacity independent of temperature, which actually is not really true if you do an experiment. So this again is completely wrong when you compare the experiment and the Drude assumption. So Drude fails in various things, the heat capacity description fails completely, large mean free path it fails completely. So definitely one needs to go and see what is a solution. This was done later, immediately after Drude's model came. Somebody else came into picture and tried to do the problem, that is the Sommerfeld model, very well known model. As written here, the difference you can immediately make it out. What is that? Earlier it was classical free electron model, Drude model. The Sommerfeld model tells you that it is quantum mechanical free electron model. That means the assumption regarding the free electron model, that is correct, that is same, no change. What is modified is classical has become quantum mechanical. That is what is the Sommerfeld model is. So all the assumptions of the root model were retained except that the treatment has become quantum mechanical. So if you look at the problem from a quantum mechanical point of view, like the way you have seen the quantum mechanical discussions here, the crystal, the metallic crystal, which where you have one mole of this crystal, you can consider that it's a box and you have these electrons put there. You have Avogadro number of electrons to be accommodated in that one, in that box, a 3D box. And the quantum mechanical 3D box, how it behaves, it has got energy levels, it has got degeneracies, discrete energy, all these things we know. So, and we also know, by this time, we also know the Fermi-Dirac statistics as it started today. So, you know the quantum mechanics of a three-dimensional box, which is actually going to represent your crystal. And you know the distribution function that will be followed by the electrons, the fermions, the Fermi-Dirac statistics we know. So, we have to combine these two so that we can find out how quantum mechanically things are different, not the way the kinetic theory can tell you. Kinetic theory gives you a continuous distribution of speeds and things like that, which actually is failing. That is why Drude model is failing, at least partially. So, to correct that, we are using the quantum mechanical picture in the lines of the discussion that you had last week, and adding to that, we have the Fermi-Dirac statistics. Combining these two, we are going to see what happens to the electron distribution, what's the difference that is going to happen from the classical kinetic theory regime to this quantum mechanical regime. That is why you are exposed to this quantum mechanical one-dimensional box, two-dimensional box, degeneracies and things like that. So, what's the problem before we proceed? There is a problem. So, pi square is not coming here. So, we know this energy levels. I am not going to spend any time. So, this is a three-dimensional box. Energy levels are given by this. So, these energy levels are to be worried about. So, we have the corresponding degeneracies as I mentioned. So, if I take an electron at your box length, if you take the box length to be something like 0.1 meter, you see that this is something like 3.76 into 10 to the power of minus 17 electron volt. This is a very, very small value. So, if I put this in a proton in the same box, you see that it is something like minus 20. So, what you are seeing is that energy separation that you have between energy levels, when you are using a box of macroscopic dimensions, L equal to 0.1 meter is a macroscopic dimension, not the angstrom dimension that you have been using for the quantum mechanics problems earlier. So, what you are actually seeing is when you, so the formula, same formula, if you substitute macroscopic quantities, values for this, the length of the box, what you are seeing is the energy levels become very close by. The separation that you saw, the discreteness that you were able to appreciate slowly disappears because these separations are actually coming down. Because of the fact that you are actually substituting a macroscopic value for L. And a crystal size, an actual crystal is macroscopic in dimensions. It is millimeter, centimeter, meter, it is not in units of angstrom. So, naturally this separation is coming to be very, very small. When the separation becomes very, very small, it actually becomes like a continuum. In some sense like a continuum. The separations are very close by. As you know, in many cases, as quantum number changes, even in the case of hydrogen atom, if you remember, as the quantum number increases, the separations become very, very close by. Energy levels becomes very, very close by. Something like that is what is happening here, because the energy levels, all of them are very close by. So, this discreteness that we know in the case of an atomic situation that you have been dealing with the quantum mechanics also here is going to change. So, when your crystal is a realistic macroscopic crystal, so, or you are putting this Avogadro number of electrons in a macroscopic crystal dimensions, the energy levels are not the way we have been seeing in the case of a textbook problems that we have been doing in quantum mechanics. They are much closer. So, when it is much closer, this idea of degeneracy is going to be difficult. because when they are separate, I can tell this has a as I showed you the how the filling happens. This is a degeneracy of 2, this is a degeneracy of 1, and things like that. But now, when they are very close by, this idea of degeneracy is not really a good one. So, whenever something is more or less continuous, what we have is a density. You have mass density, you have seen in the other course charge density, the probability density, and things like that. Wherever there is a continuous variation, you talk about the density. So, here what you have is these states, energy states are very continuous. To describe them, now we need what is known as a density of states. So, we will not worry about the degeneracies. Degeneracies what we will be completely removing, and we will purely bring in the density of states. So, when you are trying to tally the total number which has to be conserved, I will not use the concept of degeneracy, I will simply bank on the density of states. So, density of states must be chosen such that it has to take care of the whole number conservation. So, this is something which is very important, which is very different compared to the usual quantum mechanics 1D or 3D box problem. So, this is a realistic issue. So, this is what we have. Energy levels are given by this pi square h bar square n square divided by 2 ml square, where n square stands for nx, ny and nz squares. And what are these nx, ny, nz? They are nothing but integers. They must be integers. They are all n pi by l condition that was followed, so that you have a complete wave inside the box, which is a rigid box. Potential outside is infinity, inside is 0. So, nx, remember nx, ny, nz are integers. It's a very important part of our discussion now, which I am going to represent as n square. N square stands for nx square plus ny square plus nz square. Now, I want to find out how many states are there in a small, remember I am trying to talk about the density. Density of states, that means I want to find out how many states are possible in a given range of energy. Let us say between E and E plus dE, the usual calculus that we do, between E and E plus dE, how many states are possible? That is going to give me an information about the density of states. If I divide that number by the volume, I will get that actually the density of states. So, to find out the density of states, I need this information. What I am critically looking at is the number of states between energy E and E plus dE. But before I do that, if I look at this expression, I can see that E is essentially determined by n squares, because for a given problem my box is fixed, electron mass is fixed, L is fixed, all other things are constants. So, what I have to do is, I have to look at a picture. This is actually a 3-dimensional picture, but I can show only in 2-dimensional way. It is very important, please listen very carefully. What I am trying to find out is, I want to find out the number of states in the energy range between E and E plus dE. For that, before I do that, I have done, what I have done is, I have taken an integer space. What is integer space? As I told you, I am constructing a space with nx, ny, nz as the axis. And I know that the allowed values for all the three are only integers. That means, these things are all discrete, something like a lattice. This is something like a lattice, very perfectly placed at different locations. So, you can see if it is actually 3 dimensions like a cube that is shown here. And what is the separation? I have shown you one cube here. What is the volume of this cube? You remember nx, ny, nz, the separations are all 1. Nx can take value, positive values only it can take, if you remember. It can take value 1, 2, 3, 4. Similarly, for ny and nz, which means that distance between two adjacent points along any three axes will be 1 unity. That means the volume of this cube is 1 unity. This I am calling a cell. And you have to treat this problem as a 3-dimensional picture. What I am looking at is the number of states between E and E plus dE. The same thing I can tell, the number of states is nothing but number of points. Each point in this picture talks about or represents a particular energy state. Each point in this picture represents an energy state. I am trying to count them. But where I am doing the counting? I have to do the counting between a certain range of energies between E and E plus dE, which is equivalent to telling that I have to count the number of points between n and n plus dn as shown here. You see here, I have taken a spherical surface, spherical shell of radius r and radial thickness dn. So, I have to actually count the number that is coming within this. This is what is to be found out if I want to tell finally how many states are there between E and E plus DE. I am repeating this important information. What I am looking for is the number of states between E and E plus DE. For that, it is enough if I calculate the number of points that lie in the range between N and N plus DN. That is what is shown by this green circular part. Okay, that I can find out because once I know the radius and I know the radial thickness, I can find out the volume of this green portion. That is nothing but 4 pi n square dn, as all of you know. So, the volume of this part is, this green part is 4 pi n square dn. But how do I know how many points are there in that one? Because I am looking at that number, how many points are there? That points will tell me how many states are there. But how do I know that? For that, you look at this thing. Each cube has a volume of one unity. And how many points, these points, how many such points actually belong to this one cube? It is just one. Because if I put it, I mean, at the end, of course, it does not really show. But if this cube was anywhere inside, each of these corners will be actually shared by 8 such cubes. And there are 8 such corners for any given cube, which means that the actual contribution of points to a given cube, this is something similar to the simple cubic structure which you saw today morning or yesterday. So, actual lattice point, if I use borrow those terminologies, it is actually 1. So, this volume of unity corresponds to one state, one point, one state. So, if I know the total volume of this, which actually is 4 pi n square dn, and if I divide by the volume corresponding to one point, I can get a number of points. So, I have to divide this 4 pi n square dn volume divided by the volume corresponding to one point. But volume corresponding to one point is the volume of the cube, which is actually one unity. So, what I have to do is, I have to take this volume and divide it by 1. The denominator 1 is the volume corresponding to one point, which in this case is the volume of this cube, which actually is 1. So, that is what is shown here. So, this is, and as I mentioned earlier, even though the whole sphere is shown, but remember there is a restriction in this picture. Your nx, ny, nz must be all positive. You cannot have negative values, that is the assumption, because you have to have a standing wave pattern, you have to have physically allowed numbers. So, what does it mean? I am not justified in taking the whole volume, but I have to take only 1/8 of the this part where all the 3 quantum numbers nx, ny, nz are positive. Like you have a 2-dimensional case, your first quadrant is positive in every sense. Similarly, here only 1/8 will contribute to all positive scenario. So, to find out the actual number, I should take 1/8 of this thing and divide it by the volume of one cell, which is actually 1, so you do not see it here. So, 1/8 of this is pi n square dn divided by 2. So, in terms of this new variable n, the number, the density of states, which I am going to call it as gn, gn dn is nothing but pi n square dn by 2. This is the density of states that I am going to calculate for electrons, put it like this. I can convert the variable from n to e, which is not a very difficult thing at all, so that I can get an expression for GEDE, which tells you that the number of states per unit volume corresponding and the states coming in the range between E and E plus DE. Here it is n and n plus dn, that will get translated to E and E plus DE. Before we do that, we should have to worry about one more thing. So far in the quantum mechanics discussion you had in the last week, you did not worry about spin. I only use spin when we talked about magnetism. So, spin is not taken into account in any of this discussion that we had in the earlier picture, which is purely the particle in a box extension. So spin is not taken into account. So every orbit, so that means these are all orbital states that we have. Every orbital states I can put two spins, one spin up and one spin down, which means that to calculate the actual number of electrons that can be put in, I have to take this density of states and it has to be multiplied by 2 or make it double. So that every state like this can take two spins, up spin and a down spin. So the number of electrons that is possible is obtained, the number density of electrons will be actually multiplied this by 2. So this will be pi n, this 2 will go and it becomes pi n square dn. So gn dn is pi n square dn. If I change the variable from n to e, I can get an expression, again I will correct it. So these are all constants. You can see this, I'll go to the next one. Finally, it comes coming to something like this. The density of state ge de is actually proportional to e to the power of half. So that is what is shown here in the next one. Oh, this. Anyway, this is simplification. I will correct it. You can see if I plot the density of states, that is GE, as a function of energy for a three-dimensional system, a 3D solid, you can see that it has got this parabolic e to the power of half behavior, as you can see here. So this is very important for a solid which is three-dimensional. So this density of states we need to calculate the distribution, as we are going to see in the next slide. So I think because of this problem, I will leave the remaining time for questions.
Dronacharya College, Noida.
How to find the Fermi level when material behaves like a dielectric?
Okay. Oh, so that I think I will not be able to cover in this course. Please write to us. I will give the reply. So what you are basically asking is an insulating case. So something like a semiconductor. So I thought of doing some semiconductor, but I don't think we have time. So what I started is only with metals. Even that I have not reached here, reached there. So that is a different treatment. I will not be able to answer, in a couple of minutes like this. Please put the question in the email.
What are super electrons?
Okay. So the way I understand your question, what you are asking is, what is the connection between free electrons and super electrons? So super electrons are essentially, talked in the context of superconductivity. I have not talked about here in this thing. Here I was talking about, in fact I did not reach there also, trying to see what is the role of Fermi surface, what is the meaning of Fermi level, what's the importance of electrons very close to the Fermi level, how those electrons actually take part in various properties like electrical conduction, Hall effect and magnetic properties and other things. So I have not come to that level. So I have just reached there now. I have shown you the density of states. Now I have to fill the states with the density of state that I have derived. So I have to reach and I have to make sure that the total number of electrons are accommodated. So that will give me an upper limit. That is called the Fermi level. So, and I am going to show you the Fermi energy, that is the highest occupied energy, is typically 4, 5, 6 electron volts, which actually is much larger than the other energies like the thermal energy. So a very small fraction of electrons which are close to the Fermi level, they are able to participate in any of these properties like electrical conduction and things like that. Okay. So what you are asking is regarding superconductivity, the electrons which are actually getting affected so that they become a Cooper pair. There again, these electrons which are very close to the Fermi level within a small thickness, I will come to the details when I explain that, only those electrons will be able to form part of this Cooper pair. So they are called super electrons in that context, but that is not the language that I will be using when I discuss a normal metal. So the electrons which are very close to the Fermi energy, they are the ones which actually will come into picture in your super electron definition.
My question is related to yesterday's lecture.
Okay, yesterday's lecture, okay.
As it is said that superconductors are perfectly diamagnetic and superconductors need superconductors need critical temperature. Does it mean that diamagnetic are dependent on temperature?
Diamagnetic susceptibility, actually for a normal magnetic material, it is not. It is completely temperature independent, as I showed you the derivation yesterday. But superconductivity is a special case. The superconducting state, once it is in the superconducting state, of course it is diamagnetic with a susceptibility of 1, which is essentially temperature independent. But you have to start the material in the superconducting state and then define this diamagnetic susceptibility there. So you cannot tell that just because at some temperature it is becoming normal and then it is not a perfect diamagnet, there is a temperature dependence. That is not a fair comparison. So when we tell diamagnetic susceptibility is independent of temperature, we don't really mean superconductor. Superconductor is a very, very special case of a diamagnetic case. So there, of course, it has to be superconductor, otherwise the whole discussion doesn't be valid. It will not be there. So not in that context. You can't take a temperature range where it is superconducting and normal and then tell that, okay, diamagnetic susceptibility is temperature dependent. That's not a fair statement. I think I saw your question in the email. Same thing was asked, I think, in the email. So there is no contradiction in that sense, definitely not.
Yes, university BDT.
How the energy level distribution can be explained for the materials which exhibits polymorphism?
Okay, so different crystal structures, right? Right? So materials with the different crystal structures, same material in different crystal structures, how the energy levels will be different? That's a question? Okay, so this is, yeah, so this cannot be answered in a general sense. Depends on, see, definitely as we are going to see in these lectures, probably by tomorrow, second lecture I will reach there. The crystal structure plays a very important role in determining what kind of a band structure this particular solid will have. So naturally, when the crystal structure changes, let's say from cubic to something else, definitely this is going to get reflected in the band electronic band structure, and that is why the physical properties are different for different crystal systems even when the material is the same. But unless you really specifically take a particular system and study, one cannot give a general statement, okay, this will be like this and when the crystal structure is the other thing, it will be changing to this. That is not possible. But in general, there is definitely a very, very critical dependence of crystal structure on the electronic properties, which will actually determine most of the physical properties. I can give magnetism example. If you take a cubic thing and the same thing if you make in some other crystal structure, definitely there is a physical property difference. That is because the magnetic property difference, that is because of the electronic structure has completely, I mean, quite a bit changed from the first crystal structure to the second one. So there is definitely a dependence. How the dependence will come? It depends on the particular material system that you are studying. That is essentially the connection between the structure, electronic structure and the crystal structure. That's what I was talking in the beginning. That's why you first talked about crystal structure, importance of the symmetry, because symmetry will determine the energy levels, degeneracies and all other things. Naturally, there will be a dependence. That dependence is crucial in determining all the properties of that material.
Okay, sir, but if you take a particular temperature as in a transition temperature, which will change its structure, whether that particular temperature itself, the energy level distribution will change?
Of course, it will change. That is why it is undergoing a phase transition, yes. Yes, yes. In fact, the crystal structure sometimes changes, sometimes doesn't change. But in both the cases, there can be considerable physical property change because of the electronic structure changes, yes.
Yes, K.S. Rangaswamy College.
Can we achieve Bose-Einstein condensation for free electron gas?
You tell me the answer. My slide had one of the slides, it was shown like this. So can you tell whether it is possible or not? I am asking the question back to you. Yeah, I am asking, what is your thinking? What is your thinking? What do you feel? Why do you ask this question?
Because we treat this free electron model as a nearly free electron gas model.
Yeah.
So you are saying under statistical mechanics, Fermi Dirac statistics is applied here.
Yeah.
But the distribution is supposed for.
Can I interrupt you? What is the statistics that you use for Fermi Dirac particles?
Particle identical and indistinguishable.
And what is the maximum value for the Fermi Dirac function? I showed you that plus 1, importance of this plus 1 in the denominator. So what does it give you? So it gives you the probability of maximum is 1, it will violate the Pauli's principle otherwise, right? And what is Bose-Einstein condensation? You have many particles.
It is only valid for boson.
More than one particle in a given state is needed for condensation.
For BCE, we can bring all the boson. Bosons to lower quantum state. No.
But we are talking about fermions.
Can we bring all the electrons such that?
No, that's what I'm telling. Because when you are telling that it is a fermion like electron, you have to satisfy the Pauli's principle at any cost. You can't do anything with that. One energy state, one particle, nothing else. So there is no question of condensation there. There is no question of condensation. Forget about condensation. You cannot put two. You can put only one. That's the issue. That's a fundamental issue between the two. The difference between the two statistics, two nature of, two different types of particles, fermions versus bosons.
One more question.
Yeah.
Out of that, you are talking about free electrons. Suppose
yeah.
If you are taking any atom, both the number of electrons and protons are same.
Yeah.
Suppose or if you say the hole and the electron combination, suppose
yeah.
Is there any free electron means it creates a hole in the at the same case. And what about the hole conduction there?
Okay. So, remember one thing, I was giving this example of sodium always. I talked about sodium, which is a metal. And when I tell free electron, I consider only one electron per sodium atom. So, the 10 electrons of sodium atom will become part of the lattice, the positive ion core. I will take only one electron of sodium per atom. And this I am trying to fill it up and see where it is going. That gives me the Fermi level finally. We will reach there tomorrow. That discussion, and I did not come across, we did not reach the point where we have this concept of holes. Before we really get into the concept of holes, we need to do many things. In fact, in this picture that we are talking about now, the so-called free electron picture, you will not even encounter energy bands. So it needs some time for us to reach there, then we can discuss what is meant by hole. First of all, we have to define what is hole. For that, we need to really get into the band properties. We are not reached there. We are in the free electron picture where you do not have any band concept. You will have your E versus K diagram going all the way in the quadratic manner. There is no concept of energy bands coming there. So, only after you get into the concept of two different bands, this excitations, holes and other things will come. I will try to show you something towards the end of this lecture tomorrow. But right now it is too early. So in the free electron picture, this is very important, two things. One is we are completely ignoring the core electrons. We are treating them as part of the core, the lattice. The other thing is we will not encounter any kind of, that is one problem of the free electron picture finally. Even quantum mechanical treatment, the Sommerfeld model also fails. As I am going to show, it fails. One point is here where you do not get the energy bands. You can't talk about insulators, semiconductors, metals, that you can do if you use purely the free electron model. Why it happens, what is ignored in free electron model, I talked about it. Even when we do quantum mechanical treatment, those assumptions were retained from the earlier classical model. So that is a problem. So this has to be corrected, then we can see what happens when you get energy bands and the excitations and so on. Then we can define what is a hole, I will do that, and then we can talk about this.
From yesterday's lecture,
yeah,
I asked this question.
Yeah, please.
Why do the magnetic reversals happen? What would happen if they did not occur further?
I did not talk about it in yesterday's lecture. If it is a paramagnetic material, if I apply a magnetic field and if I reverse the magnetic field, nothing is going to happen. If it's a ferromagnet, it is actually going to have some effect, because if I reverse the magnetic field, it is going to have some properties retained. That I am going to discuss in my third or fourth lecture anyway. So that is what is very making the ferromagnets important in various applications. For a paramagnet, it is completely reversible, it will simply come back, it does not matter. There is no hysteresis. What is actually happening when you talk about this reversibility is the hysteresis. In the case of paramagnet, there is no hysteresis. Whereas in any ordered system, you will have hysteresis, actually it is a loss in some sense, in many senses it is actually bad, in some cases it is needed. So only in the context of ferromagnets you talk about this hysteresis or the problem of reversibility or irreversibility. In a paramagnet, no, but I yesterday talked about only paramagnets.